بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, العلماء ورثة الأنبياء, that the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. وإن الأنبياء لم يورثوا دينارا ولا درهما وإنما ورثوا العلم. Because the prophets did not leave behind any wealth, any money, but they left behind knowledge. فَمَنْ أَخَذَهُ أَخَذَ بِحَظٍ وَافِرٍ. So whoever takes a portion of that knowledge has taken a good portion. So the scholars take the role of the prophets in terms of the fact they have taken that knowledge from what was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, both from the Book of Allah and his Sunnah, and they convey it to the people. And likewise, just as the people would go to the Prophet ﷺ, ask him questions and so on, likewise, the ulama fulfill the same role. And that's why we have been commanded in the Quran to go back to the people of knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. So we have been commanded to respect the people of knowledge and to go back to them and to learn from them and to benefit from them. And alhamdulillah, today we have an excellent opportunity where two of those scholars from Al-Madinah Al-Munawwarah, the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they have come to us and we can benefit from them. And the first of these scholars is Sheikh Abdul Salam Al-Sahimi Hafizahullah, who has been teaching in the Islamic University of Medina in the Faculty of Sharia for decades. And he was for many years also in charge of the faculty as well. And also he's been teaching in Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi as well. And even until now he still has lessons in Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi. So without any delay, I'll pass it over to the Sheikh bi-iznillah, and he has a talk which is titled A'mal al-Qulub, the actions of the hearts. So without any delay, I'll pass it to the Sheikh. فليتفضل مشكورا.
الحمد لله أحمده على نعمه الباطنة والظاهرة، جعل الدنيا مزرعة للآخرة، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الحمد في الأولى والآخرة، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله المؤيد بالمعجزات الباهرة، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه نجوم الهدى الزاهرة، وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، فيسرني أيها الأخوة أن ألتقي بكم في هذا المسجد لنتدارس شيئًا مما يتعلق بدين الإسلام الذي هو دين المسلمين، وهو الذي ختم الله به الديانات بعد مبعث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. وسيكون عنوان المحاضرة أعمال القلوب، وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا وإياكم للعلم النافع والعمل الصالح، وأن يحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها، وأن يجيرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة.
So the Shaykh, he started off by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he said that I am very happy to see all of you today in this masjid so that we can learn a bit about this religion of Islam, the religion of the Muslims, the final religion which was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the sending of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the title of today's lecture is A'mal al-Qulub, Actions of the Hearts. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to beneficial knowledge and to righteous actions and to make us successful both in this life and the hereafter.
خلق الله سبحانه وتعالى القلب وجعله ملكا للأعضاء والأعضاء جنوده، فإذا طاب الملك طابت جنوده. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول ألا وإن في الجسد مضغة إذا صلحت صلح الجسد كله، وإذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله، ألا وهي القلب.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has created the heart as the king of the body, and the rest of the limbs of the body are its troops. So therefore, if the king is upright, then likewise his troops will also be upright. And that's taken from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, "Ala wa inna fil jasadi mudghah," that verily there is a morsel of flesh in the body. If it is sound, then the rest of the body will be sound, and if it is corrupt, then the rest of the body will be corrupt, and that is the heart.
فهو عن القلب محل التقوى والإيمان، أو الكفر والشرك والنفاق. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم: التقوى ها هنا، وأشار إلى صدره 3 مرات.
So the heart is either the place where iman and the taqwa of Allah and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is placed, or it could be a place where hypocrisy and kufr is filled with. And this is what was indicated by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he pointed towards the chest, towards the heart 3 times, and he said, "At-taqwa hahuna, taqwa is over here, taqwa is over here, taqwa is over here."
وَالْإِيمَانْ قَوْلْ وَعَمَلْ وَاعْتِقَادٍ. قَوْلْ بِاللِّسَانْ وَاعْتِقَادٍ بِالْجَنَانِ اللي هو القلب، وعمل بالجوارح. فإذا صدق القلب في الاعتقاد تحرك اللسان بالذكر، قراءة القرآن، بالشهادة، وكذلك تحركت الجوارح بالأعمال الصالحة.
And as we know, that iman comprises of 3 things. It is belief in the heart, statement upon the tongue, and actions upon the limbs. So the foundation is the heart. If the heart is upright and if it is truthful, then this will cause the tongue to move with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it will cause the limbs to move with the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
فالجسد تابع للقلب، فما في القلب يظهر على الجوارح، يظهر على اللسان ويظهر على بقية أعضاء الجسد بالعمل. نعم.
So the body and the limbs that a person has, they follow what is in the heart. And whatever is in the heart, then a proof of that is shown and manifested on a person's tongue and on a person's limbs.
والمراد بالأعمال القلبية هي التي يكون محلها القلب، وأعظمها الإيمان.
What we mean by actions of the heart, i.e. those concepts in Islam where the place or where it rests is the heart. And the greatest of these actions is al-iman.
ومنه التصديق الانقيادي والإقرار.
And from this iman is that a person believes and affirms the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
بالإضافة إلى ما يقع في قلب العبد لربه سبحانه وتعالى من المحبة والخوف والرجاء والإنابة والتوكل والصبر واليقين والخشوع وغير ذلك من أعمال القلوب.
And other actions of the heart include having the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having the fear of Allah, having tawakkul, reliance upon Allah, having patience, having certainty, having humbleness, and so on.
وكل عمل من أعمال القلوب فإن ضده مرض من أمراض القلوب. فالإخلاص ضده الرياء، واليقين ضده الشك، والمحبة ضدها البغض.
And each of these actions of the heart, their opposite is considered an illness of the heart. So for example, we have sincerity. The opposite of sincerity is showing off. And showing off is one of the illnesses of the hearts. Likewise, we have from the actions of the hearts, certainty. And the opposite of certainty is doubt. And that is an illness. Also, we have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, the illness is having hatred for Allah or anything connected to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on.
فإذا غفلنا عن إصلاح قلوبنا تراكمت الذنوب شيئا فشيئا كلا برانا على قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون.
And if we become heedless regarding rectifying our hearts, then our sins will cover all of our hearts, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in the Quran, كَلَّ بَلْرَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. That due to the actions that the people used to do, their hearts are now tarnished with the sins that they have done.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم: إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ إِذَا أَخْطَأَ خَطِيئَةً نُكِتَ فِي قَلْبِهِ نُكْتَةً فَإِنْ هُوَ نَزَعَ وَاسْتَغْفَرَ وَتَابَ سُقِلَتْ وَإِنْ هُوَ عَاد زِيدَ فِيهِ حَتَّى تَعْلُو فِيهِ. وهذا هو الران المذكور في القرآن في قوله تعالى: كلا بران على قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون.
And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in a hadith that verily the slave, if he commits a sin, then a black dot is placed on his heart, and if he deters from that sin, and seeks forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that black dot is removed. But if he continues and goes back to that sin, then the blackness will increase until his whole heart is covered in darkness and in blackness. And this is the meaning of the word rana in the ayah, kalla bal rana ala qulubihim, that when the heart is tarnished, i.e. this is what happens to the heart, all these black dots are placed upon the heart until the heart is fully covered in darkness.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم تعرض الفتن على القلوب كالحصير عودا عودا فأي قلب أشربها نكتت فيه نكتة سوداء وأي قلب أنكرها نكت فيه نكتة بيضاء حتى تصير على قلبين أبيض مثل الصفاء فلا تضره فتنة ما دامت السماوات والأرض وأسود مربادا كالكوز مجخيا لا يعرف معروفا ولا ينكر منكرا إلا ما أشرب من هواه.
And likewise, another similar hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned how fitan, trials and tribulations, they come in front of the heart, just like a person, if he was to lie down on a bed made out of straw, if he was to get up, then that straw would stick to that person. Likewise, these fitan, they cling on and they stick to a person's heart. So if a person rebukes all of these fitan and these illnesses that come towards his heart, then his heart becomes white and pure. Otherwise, it becomes dark and black. And if a person has a white heart, then no fitna would have an effect on that person's heart for as long as the heavens and the earth remain. But if a person has a black heart, then he will not know what is good, and he will not rebuke or he will not refrain from that which is evil.
نقطة يعني نقطة تكون في من أثار الذنوب نقطة. كالحصير عودا عودا الحصير هذا هو الفراش الذي يكون في الأرض ويكون يعني الشيء الذي يتكون منه هذا الحصير متلاصق العود بجانب عود كذلك هذه النكت تكون في القلب فتكون متجاورة كل ما حصل معصية وذنب جاءت نكتة وهكذا
الشيخ carried on to explain the hadith that the word nukta means like a black dot. And the example given at the other hadith was a bed made out of straw. So just as all the straws overlap and coincide with one another, likewise these black dots do the same thing to a person's heart until the whole heart is covered in darkness.
فَإِذَا الْعَبْدُ اسْتَغْفَرَ وَتَابْ مَحَلَّهُ هَذِهِ النُّكْتَةَ السَّوْدَى الَّتِي فِي قَلْبِهُ وَأَصْبَحَتْ بَيْضَاءَ بِسَبَبِ التَّوْبَةِ وَالْمَغْفِرَةِ.
And even if a person, if he does fall into these sins, if he turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asks Allah for forgiveness, then Allah will remove this black dot which has been placed until his heart becomes a pure white heart.
حتى تعود يعني قلوب العباد إلى قلبين أبيض مثل الصفاء. الصفاء هو الحجر الأملس يعني ما يضره الشيء ما يعلق به.
So we want to make sure that our hearts return back to this white, pure heart. And this white, pure heart is like a pearl, where nothing sticks onto it, but it's something which is pure.
فَلَا تَضُرُّهُ فِتْنَةً لأنه عرف الحق ولزم الحق ودعا إلى الحق وصبر على الحق.
And when trials and tribulations come towards it, it will not have an effect on that heart, because that heart knows the truth and it follows the truth and it sticks to the truth and it calls to the truth.
القلب الآخر الذي غطي بالذنوب وصفه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بأنه كالكوز مجخيا. الكوز هو الإناء. أنت إذا قلبت الإناء مجخي يعني مقلوب. إذا قلبت الإناء فإنه ما في مكان يستوعب الماء فيصبح بعد ذلك ما يعرف لا معروف ولا ينكر منكر إلا الشيء الذي يهواه قلبه.
And the other type of heart that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the hadith is that darkened heart. And the example given the hadith is like if you were to take a cup and if you were to turn it upside down, if a person was to pour water, no water would go inside of that cup if it is upside down. So likewise, the heart which has become darkened, if it's fully dark, then any good that comes to it, it will not benefit from it.
ومعرفة أعمال القلوب أفرض وأوجب على الإنسان من معرفة أعمال الجوارح لأن أعمال الجوارح هي فرع عن أعمال القلوب ومبنية عليها، فإذا لم تصح أعمال القلوب لا تصح أعمال الجوارح.
So knowing the actions of the heart is more obligatory upon a person than knowing the rulings regarding the actions of a person's limbs. Why? Because the limbs are a branch of what is already in the heart.
لأن أعمال الجوارح مكملة ومتممة وثمرة لأعمال القلوب.
The actions of the limbs, they complete what is in the heart and they are a manifestation of what is in the heart.
ولذلك جاء في الحديث إن الله لا ينظر إلى صوركم وإنما ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم.
And that's why it comes in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does not look at your wealth nor at your outer appearance, but rather he looks at your hearts and your actions.
إن الله لا ينظر إلى صوركم وأموالكم وإنما ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم، هذه التي ينظر إليها الله عز وجل.
So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at. As for the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he looks at our hearts, which is the foundation, and then he looks at our actions. And Allah does not look at our outer appearance nor our wealth.
فلذلك القلب هو محل التفكر والتدبر والعلم، فلذلك كان التفاضل بين الناس بحسب ما يكون في القلوب.
And the heart is a place of pondering and of knowledge and of contemplation. And that's why the differences between the people is, it goes back to the differences between their hearts.
قال الحسن البصري رحمه الله تعالى عن أبي بكر الصديق والله ما سبقهم بكثير صلاة ولا صوم وإنما سبقهم بما وقر في قلبه، يعني من قوة إيمانه وتصديقه رضي الله عنه.
And that's الحسن البصري رحمه الله, when he was describing and talking about Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه, he said that Abu Bakr did not precede his contemporaries due to praying more or fasting more than them, but he was better than them due to what was in his heart, i.e. from the iman, conviction, affirmation that he had in his heart.
لذلك أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه لما أخبر بأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أسري به من مكة من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى ثم أرج به إلى السماء، ماذا قال؟ قال للناس هل قاله النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ قالوا نعم. قال إذن صدق، طالما أنه قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقد صدق، لذلك سمي بالصديق.
And that's why Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when the news came to him that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had traveled all the way to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and then all the way to the heavens in one night and returned, what was his answer? His answer was, is this something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? And if it is, then I believe in it. Hence why he was given the name As-Siddiq.
أعمال القلوب أفضل من أعمال الجوارح من عدة وجوه.
The actions of the hearts are better and more important than the actions of the limbs due to a number of reasons.
لأن أعمال القلوب يعني إذا صلحت صلحت أعمال الجوارح، إذا فسدت فسدت أعمال الجوارح.
Firstly, because if the heart is sound, then the actions of the limbs are also sound. And if the hearts are corrupt, then the limbs and actions are also corrupt.
فاختلال العبادة عبادة القلب قد يهدم عبادة الجوارح، مثلا الرياء يهدم العمل الذي يدخل فيه.
And maybe a person does a good action of the limbs, but due to what is taking place in the person's heart, it destroys the action that he has done. For example, if a person was to pray or something similar to that, but then he was showing off, then the action of the limbs will not be accepted.
أعمال القلب هي الأساس، فما وقع من لفظ أو حركة بغير قصد فلا يؤاخذ الإنسان فيها، لا يؤاخذ الإنسان فيها طالما أنه لم يقصدها. فأعمال القلب هي الأساس، قد تقع حركة من الإنسان ولفظ غير قاصد له وغير متعمد له، هذا لا يؤاخذ عليه. نعم.
And because the heart is the source and it is the foundation, if a person was to say a statement or do an action but without realizing or without an intention, he does it accidentally, for example, then he is not taken to account for the action. Why? Because the heart is not involved in that action.
مثلا سبب الأعمال القلوب سبب للمراتب العليا في الجنة كالزهد.
And also the actions of the hearts are a means of attaining the highest ranks of Jannah, and also they lead to those actions which lead to the highest ranks of Jannah, such as الزهد asceticism.
ذكر الإمام أحمد لما سئل عن الزهد أنه ثلاث مراتب: زهد العوام بترك الحرام، و زهد العلماء بترك الفضول، أي شيء من الفضول تركه، وزهد الصادقين الصديقين هو أنه لا يشغله شيء عن محبة الله عز وجل. هذا هو الزهد، لا يشغله شيء كائنا من كان عما يحبه الله عز وجل ويرضاه.
And Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, when he was asked regarding the meaning of az-zuhd, Imam Ahmad replied that az-zuhd is of three levels. There's the first level where this is for the general people, where they understand az-zuhd to be tark al-haram, leaving off that which is haram. Then you have the level of the scholars where they leave off that which has no benefit. But then the highest level is the level of those who are truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is leaving off anything which distracts them from the remembrance of Allah and loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
أنها أشق أن أعمال القلوب من أعمال الجوارح. يقول ابن المنكدر رحمه الله تعالى: كابدت نفسي 40 سنة حتى استقامت.
And the rectification of the hearts is the rectification of all of the person's affairs. And that's why Ibn al-Munkadir, he said that I used to fight and try to rectify my heart for 40 years until finally I got to the level I wanted to get to.
وأنها أجمل أثرا كالحب في الله، عندما يحب شخصا في الله فهذه لها أثرها، فهي أكبر أثرا من وأجمل أثرا من عمل الجوارح.
Also, another difference is that the effects of rectifying the hearts are more beautiful and more beneficial than the effects of the actions of the limbs. For example, loving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it's loving another person or a place and so on, this is one of the effects of the rectification of a person's heart, which is not found in the rectification of a person's limbs.
أنها أعظم أجراً. قال أبو الدرداء رضي الله عنه: تفكر ساعة خير من قيام ليلة.
And also the reward is greater. That's Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. He said that just pondering with my heart for an hour is better than standing for the whole night in prayer.
عندما يتفكر الإنسان في عظيم صنع الله وخلق الله عز وجل وإيجاده للجنة والنار ومراتب الجنة ومراتب النار والخوف من الله والرجاء فيما عند الله عز وجل واعتماد القلب على الله، هذه الأشياء عندما يفكر فيها الإنسان ليعرف معناها ويعمل بمقتضاها تكون أشد أثرا عليه حتى من قيام الليل مع عظيم الأجر في قيام الليل.
So if a person was to just ponder regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatness of Allah, the greatness of the creation of Allah, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared the bliss of paradise and the punishment of the hereafter, and a person ponders over the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hope in his reward, and that causes a person to act in accordance with that and what that necessitates, then that is much more greater in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than praying the whole night, even though praying the whole night is from the greatest of actions.
أيضا هي التي تحرك الجوارح. فالإنسان إذا خاف الله عز وجل امتنع عن فعل المعاصي. إذا أحب الله عز وجل أحب أن يقوم بالعبادة التي شرعها الله عز وجل. إذا رجاء ما عند الله فإنه يرغبه في الإكثار من العمل الصالح.
Likewise, the actions of the heart, it is what causes the limbs to move and to do actions. So for example, if a person, he has the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his heart, that would prevent him from falling into sin because he fears the punishment. If a person loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he would love to worship Allah. If a person hopes and really wants the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that will encourage him in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more.
أنها تعظم أجر العبادة كالخشوع في الصلاة أو تبطلها كالرياء في مع العمل.
It could multiply the rewards of certain actions. For example, if a person has more khushu', more humility and concentration in their salah, that will increase the reward of that prayer that he is praying. And likewise, it could do the opposite. If a person was to pray, but he is showing off with his heart that his intention is to pray for somebody else, then it will nullify the action that he is doing.
أنها قد تعوض عن العمل. مثلا شخص ما عنده مال لكنه ينوي أنه لو كان عنده مال لتصدق، إذن هنا يحصل له الأجر مع أنه لم يتصدق بشيء من أجل هذه النية الصالحة.
And from the beautiful differences is that sometimes just by having the action of the heart, a person could be rewarded for the action of the limbs even if he doesn't do that action. So for example, if a person, he saw something and with his heart, he wanted to give charity. He wanted to give money for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he doesn't have that money, that even though he hasn't given that charity, he will still be rewarded for it.
أنها ليس لها حد في الأجر كالصبر. قال تعالى إنما يوفى الصابرون أجرهم بغير حساب.
Also, the rewards for the actions of the hearts, they have no limit. And that's why you'll find many ayat where some of these actions of the hearts, Allah ta'ala, he talks about them and he describes them as from those actions that have no limits. For example, Allah says regarding patience, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards those that have patience without any accountability, i.e. without any limit.
أنه لا يتوقف أجرها ما توقف الجوارح عن العمل. شخص ينوي فعل الطاعات من واجبات ومن نوافل, فإذا مرض أو سافر وقل عمله فإنه يكتب له من الأجر مثل ما كان يعمل صحيحا, وهذا من أثر أعمال القلوب.
Also from the effects of the actions of the hearts is that just because a person's limbs might stop working or stop doing what he used to do, due to the actions of the heart, a person could still be gaining the same reward. For example, if there's a person who does certain actions constantly, but then he becomes ill or he travels, and due to these external reasons, those actions of obedience become less, then a person will still get the same reward as what he could have done if his health was good and he wasn't traveling. And another difference between the actions of the heart and actions of the limbs is that the actions of the heart, it starts before the action and it continues all the way through the action until the end.
والقلب يمر بمراحل قبل أن تعمل الجوارح. قبل أن يشرع في عمل الجوارح, ما في القلب يمر بعدة مراحل. أولها الهاجس, وهو الفكرة أول ما تلقى في القلب.
And before the action of the heart turns into an action of the limbs, the heart goes through a number of different stages. The first stage is a thought. So the first action of the heart before a person does the actual action is that it starts with just a thought in a person's heart.
والثاني هو الخاطرة, وهي ما يثبت في القلب.
And then the second is known as khatira, which is not just a random thought, but a thought which has now stuck in a person's heart, where he's constantly thinking about it.
الثالثة حديث النفس, وهو التردد يعني بين الفعل أو الترك.
Then the third is known as حديث النفس, where a person literally translates to when he speaks to himself, but what this refers to is now a person is debating should he do the action or not do the action.
الرابع هو الهم, وهو العزم على الفعل.
And then number four,
يعني أن يترجح عنده الفعل.
And then the fourth is al-ham, where a person now has a determination to do the action. So number three was he was debating whether to do it or not, and number four he's finally decided that he's going to do the action.
الخامس هو العزم, وهو قوة القصد والجزم بالفعل. هذه المرحلة الخامسة.
And then the fifth is a level even higher. Not only has he decided to do it, but he's now really determined. He's about to get up and he's planned on how to do it, and now he's ready to execute that plan.
فالثلاثة الأولى لا أجر لها في الحسنة ولا إثم في المعصية، اللي هي إيش؟ اللي هي الهاجس والتفكر والخاطرة.
The first, so we mentioned five stages. The first three, which is just having a random thought and then a thought which sticks, and the third, hadith al-nafs, where a person debates whether to do it or not. These three stages, there's no sin or no reward attached to these three stages.
وأما الهم فتكتب له الحسنة إذا هم بها ولا تكتب السيئة إذا هم بها.
As for alham, where a person now has decided what to do, so number four, just before he has that full determination, he's just decided to do it. For this, a person, he does get a reward just for his intention, but he does not get any sin if he intended to do something bad.
وأما العزم على فعل السيئة فإنه يكتب له سيئة وإن لم يعمل بها.
And as for the final and fifth one, where a person now he's planned and he's ready to execute the action, then if he has intended good, he will be rewarded. And now here is where if he intends bad, he will, even if he doesn't do the action, it will be written as a sin.
لأن الإرادة مع القدرة تستلزم وجود المقدور.
Because this firm intention where a person is ready to execute it, that necessitates that the action will take place even if there was something to stop him from doing it.
ولذلك قال تعالى إن الذين يحبون أن تشيع الفاحشة في الذين آمنوا لهم عذاب أليم. هذا محبة الفاحشة مع أنه لم يعمل. نعم.
تعيد العائشة.
إن الذين يحبون أن تشيع الفاحشة في الذين آمنوا لهم عذاب أليم.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran that verily those who love to spread evil and immoral actions between those that have iman, these people will have a painful punishment. So these people, they just want evil to spread even amongst the righteous people. That intent, that which is the fifth level, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding them that they have azabun aleem, a painful punishment.
وقال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا التقى المسلمان بسيفيهما فالقاتل والمقتول في النار. يقول الراوي قلت يا رسول الله ما بال المقتول؟ قال إنه كان حريصا على قتل صاحبه.
And likewise in the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says that if two Muslims meet each other with their swords, then the killer and the one who is killed are both in the hellfire. So the Sahaba asked, they said the one who killed his brother, that makes sense, because we're not allowed to kill one another. But the one who is killed, him also. And the Prophet ﷺ said yes, because he had that firm determination to kill his brother as well. He just wasn't able to.
إن ترك المعصية بعد العزم عليها فهو على أربعة أقسام. يعني عزم على فعل المعصية لكنه تركها. فهذه على أربعة أقسام. إن كان تركها خوفا من الله فهذا يؤجر.
Now the Shaykh, he moves on to another issue and he says, now if a person has a firm determination to do a sin, but then he decides not to do that sin and he stops himself at the last moment, then there are four different scenarios. The first scenario is that he stops himself from doing that sin due to the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If that is the case, then this person is rewarded.
أن يتركها ليس خوفا من الله وإنما خوفا من الناس فهذا يأثم أيضا بالنية الجازمة. نعم.
The second is that a person he leaves it off not out of fear of Allah but out of fear of the people that he'll be exposed and so on. This person is still sinful.
لأن ترك المعصية عبادة ولا بد أن يكون لله.
Because leaving off a sin is also an act of worship. So the intention should be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not for the people.
إذا تركها عجزا دون أن يفعل الوسائل التي توصل إليها فهذا أيضا يأثم بالنية الجازمة.
The third scenario is that a person he leaves off that sin because he's not capable, he doesn't have the ability to do that sin. This person is also sinful because he had that firm intention.
إذا تركها عجزا مع فعل الوسائل الموصلة إليها لكن لم يتحقق مراده فهذا يكتب عليها الإثم كاملا.
And the fourth is a level slightly more where a person he was able to not do the action exactly how it was but he was able to do everything which would take him to nearly completing that sin but he wasn't able to complete it, so he's taken all of the wasail, all of the means, so he's prepared everything. This person gains the full sin.
لأن الإرادة الجازمة التي أتي معها بالممكن من العمل يجري صاحبها مجرى الفاعل التام.
Because this final stage where a person has a firm determination to execute that plan, this takes the same ruling as a person doing the action.
ومتى اقترن العمل بالهم فإنه يعاقب عليه سواء كان الفعل متأخرا أو متقدما.
And if a person has that firm determination to do a sin, then he is sinful whether he does that sin straight away or whether he does that sin later on.
فمن فعل محرما مرة ثم عزم على فعله متى قدر عليه فهو مصر على المعصية.
So an example is that a person has made a firm determination to do a sin. And he makes that determination that he will do that sin at the first chance he gets. All the way until he does that sin, that all that time is considered him being in a state of sin.
ومعاقب على هذه النية وإن لم يعد إلى عمله.
And he will be punished for, or he's deserving of punishment for that sin throughout all of that time, even if at the time of doing that sin he wasn't able to do it.
هناك بعض الأعمال كأمثلة من أعمال القلوب منها النية وهي بمعنى الإرادة والقصد.
So now we're going to mention some examples of some of the actions of the hearts that a person should try to do or rectify. The first is a person's intention.
ولا يصح أي عمل يقصد به وجه الله إلا بها. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى.
And no action can be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except if a person has the correct intention, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the famous hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَلُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. Verily actions are according to their intentions. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ مُرِئٍ مَّا نَوَىٰ. And verily every person will attain that which he has intended.
قال ابن المبارك رحمه الله تعالى رب عمل صغير تكبره النية وربما عمل كبير تصغره النية.
So Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahimahullah, he said that maybe a person does a small action, but the reward is great due to his intention. And maybe a person does a great action, but the reward is little due to his intention.
فإن كان العمل لله سمي إخلاصا وهو أن يكون العمل لله لا نصيب لغيره فيه.
And if a person does an action for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that is known as ikhlas, sincerity.
وإن كان العمل لغير الله سمي رياء أو نفاقا.
And if a person does an action for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that is known as either riya, which is showing off, or it is known as hypocrisy, nifaq.
والناس أيها الأخوة كلهم هلكا إلا العالمون.
And all of the people are in loss and in destruction except for those people that have knowledge.
والعالمون كلهم هلكا إلا العاملون.
And all those that have knowledge will also be in loss and in destruction unless they act upon that knowledge.
والعاملون كلهم هلكا إلا المخلصون.
And though all of those that do the actions will all be destroyed and in loss unless they are sincere in their actions.
فالوظيفة لكل عبد أراد طاعة الله تعلم النية. هذه الوظيفة الأولى.
So the first thing that any person that wants to do a righteous action, the first thing that he needs to do is تعلم النية, to learn and to rectify his intention.
ثم يصححها بالعمل بعد فهم حقيقة الصدق والإخلاص.
And then after being truthful with Allah and sincere to him, then he does that action.
فالعمل بغير نية عناء وتعب.
And if a person does an action without the correct intention, then he has just wasted his time and become tired without any benefit.
والنية بغير إخلاص رياء.
And an intention.
والنية بغير إخلاص رياء.
And if a person has an intention without sincerity, that is known as رياء, showing off.
والإخلاص من غير تحقيق إيمان هباء. And لا قيمة له.
And if a person is sincere but he has no iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that is, as Allah mentioned in the Quran, haba, it's like scattered dust.
والأعمال ثلاثة أنواع. معاصي.
Actions are of three types. The first is sins.
فالنية الحسنة في المعصية لا تقلبها طاعة. ما تنقلب طاعة بالقصد الحسن.
If a person wants to do a sin but he has a good intention behind that sin, then he's still sinning. Just because a person has a good intention, it doesn't make the action correct.
وأن وضيف إليها قصد خبيث كان له وزرها وتضاعف وزرها عليه.
And if he has a bad intention with that sin that he is doing, then his sin is doubled. One is for the action and one is for the evil intention behind it.
يعني كونه يفعل المعصية بحسن نية هذا لا يصحح له عمله. وكونه بنية خبيثة هذا يزداد وزره.
So if a person was to do a sin or an action which is incorrect, if he has a good intention behind it, then it doesn't make the action correct. It is still a sin. But if a person does that sin or action which is incorrect with an evil intention, then he has just doubled or increased in sin.
العمل الثاني المباح. الأشياء المباحة.
The second type of action is the مباح actions, the permissible actions.
فممكن يعني بالنية الطيبة أن تكون قربة وعبادة ويؤجر عليها.
If a person does an action which is permissible, such as eating and drinking, if a person has a good intention behind that, then that normal action, that permissible action, can become an act of worship.
مثلا يأكل الطعام ليتقوى على طاعة الله، ينام ليستريح فيقوى على طاعة الله. فهذا وإن كان في الأصل مباح، لكن بهذه النية يكون عبادة.
For example, a person he eats so that he can have strength to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or he sleeps so that he can wake up and pray and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though eating and sleeping is a normal action, permissible action, which in its origin has no reward or sin behind it, due to a person's good intention, this permissible action has now become a recommended action or an act of worship.
النوع الثالث من الأعمال هو الطاعات.
The third type of actions are righteous actions.
وهي مرتبطة بالنيات في أصل صحتها ومضاعفة أجرها.
And it is connected. Actions of obedience are connected to intentions in two ways, both in the acceptance of the action and also in the reward of the action.
فإن والرياء صارت معصية وقد تكون شركا أكبر وقد تكون شركا أصغر.
If a person does a righteous action but he shows off in that action, then this is considered showing off and it could even lead to hypocrisy.
وهي على ثلاثة أوجه. أن يكون الباعث على العبادة مراعاة الناس من الأصل. فهذا شرك والعبادة باطلة.
As for showing off in an action, then there are three scenarios. The first is that a person, he does a righteous action and the origin of the action is showing off, meaning the reason he's got up to do that action is to show off to the people. This is considered a type of shirk because he's doing the action for other than Allah and that act of worship is not accepted from him.
أن يكون العمل لله ثم دخلت عليه نية الرياء.
The second scenario is that the person started the act of worship for the sake of Allah, but during the action, the intention of showing off came to him later.
فإن كانت العبادة لا ينبني آخرها على أولها كالصدقة فأولها صحيح وآخرها باطل.
So if a person he starts off that action for the sake of Allah and then later on he has the intention to show off and he continues with that intention, we have to look at this action. If that action has different parts, then the part where he was sincere is accepted and the part where he wasn't is not. For example, a person he gives sadaqah, he gives charity to a number of different people. Those where he was sincere is accepted and those where he wasn't is rejected.
يعني بدأ بالصدقة بنية صالحة وأخرج شيء منها لكن ثم بعد ذلك رأى فما كان يعني من أولها بنية صالحة له أجره لكن ما دخل فيه الرياء فهنا يذهب أجره.
So the same example as before, he starts off giving charity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Later on he realizes people are looking at him and so on and now he wants to show off. So his niyyah, his intention changes later on. Then the first few actions that were sincere, it is accepted and he's rewarded and then the later ones are rejected.
فإن كان العبادة يبنى آخرها على أولها كالصلاة فهي على حالين. الحالة الأولى أن يدافع الرياء، أن يوجد الرياء لكن صار يدافعه، ففي هذه الحالة لا يؤثر على العمل.
If all of the action is all connected, it's not different parts. For example, salah, the beginning of salah till the end is all connected. It's one action that we do without any break. These types of actions which are all connected also have two scenarios. The first is that if a person fights off that intention, so shaitans come to him, change his intention, and he fights off that intention and changes his intention, and he fights off shaitan's whispers and he keeps it sincere, then that whisper that came to him for that few moments will not have an effect on him.
فإن اطمأن إلى الرياء فتبطل جميعها.
However, if when that whisper comes to him of showing off and he accepts it and he continues the rest of the prayer or the rest of the act of obedience showing off, then it will nullify the whole action.
أن يكون الرياء بعد العمل فهذه وساوس لا أثر لها.
And the third, we've already talked about having the intention to show off before the action, during, and the third is having the intention to show off after the action, that does not have an effect on the action that has already been done.
أما إن كان قصده من العمل الصالح دنيا يصيبها فإن أجرها وإثمها على قدر نيته.
If a person does a righteous action to attain not the praise of the people but to attain something from the dunya, some wealth or status and so on, then the sin that he attains is corresponding to how evil that intention is.
وهو على ثلاث أحوال. أن يكون الدافع للعمل الدنيا فقط.
And this is also three scenarios where a person does an action for the dunya, for this world. Three scenarios. The first is that a person, by doing his action, he's doing it only for the sake of worldly benefits.
كمن يؤم الناس في الصلاة لأخذ المال فقط فهو معذور آثم.
So for example, a person, he leads the people in prayer just so he can attain money. The reason he's leading people in prayer is so that he can make some money. This person is sinful.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من تعلم علما مما يبتغى به وجه الله لا يتعلمه إلا ليصيب به عرضا من الدنيا ولأجل الدنيا لم يرح رائحة الجنة.
And that's what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said that whoever learns something which should only be learned for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he does so that he can attain something from this dunya, he will not smell the fragrance of paradise.
لفظ الحديث لم يجد عرف الجنة والعرف هو ريحة الجنة.
Now the wording of the hadith is عرف الجنة, and عرف means ريح, the wind.
هذه الحالة الأولى. الحالة الثانية أن يعمل لوجه الله ولأجل الدنيا.
The second is that a person does it for both. He does this action for the sake of Allah, but also for the sake of attaining something in this life.
فإنه ناقص الإيمان والإخلاص كمن يحج للتجارة والحج فأجره على قدر إخلاصه.
This person, his reward is deficient. So depending on how sincere he is, that's how much reward he will attain. So if he wants it more for the sake of Allah, it's more reward. But if he's doing it more for the dunya, then it is less reward.
الحالة الثالثة أن يعمل لله وحده ولكنه يأخذ جعلا, والجعل هو ما يجريه الإمام أو من ينوب على الإمام من أرزاق للعاملين كالأئمة والمؤذنين والقضاء والمدرسين ونحو ذلك, هذا لا ينقص بما يأخذ.
The third is that a person does an action for the sake of Allah, but he takes money as a ju'l. A ju'l is something which aids him in that action, such as an imam of a masjid. He wants to lead the people in prayer, he wants to teach the people, but at the same time he has bills to pay and a family to look after. So he takes some money for that so that he can continue doing what he continue worship Allah, and he doesn't need to take a second job, for example. This has no effect on a person.
يعني مثلا شخص يؤم الناس بجعل يجعل له بسبب الإمام وارتباطه بها يأخذه من الإمام من ولي الأمر أو من ينوب عنه أو من غير لكن لو كان مثلا الإمام يقول للمصلين ما أصلي بكم إلا كل واحد يعطيني كذا من المال, هذا هو الذي يعني لا يؤجر وإنما يأثم.
So there's a difference between the two scenarios. If you take the example of the imam, where it is permissible, it is where the imam would take something so that it can aid him in the righteous action that he is doing. So his intention, his primary intention is to do the righteous actions, and then the worldly benefit is something which aids him in doing that. But the scenario where he is sinful is where a person does the action for the sake of the money. So for example, he will say, I'm not going to lead you in prayer until you give me some money. So he's doing it not to lead the people, not to do righteous action. He's only doing it so he can make some money.
بالنسبة للعاملين المخلصين هم على درجات ثلاث.
Now, as for another issue is as for those people who do righteous actions sincerely for Allah, then there are three types of people.
دنيا يعني أقل شيء وهي أن يعمل الطاعة رجاء للثواب أو خوف من العقاب.
The first is that person does an action for the sake of the dunya, whether it's in attaining a reward or staying or being protected from a punishment.
ووسطى أن يعمل الطاعة شكرا لله عز وجل واستجابة لأمره. ووسطى أن يعمل الطاعة شكرا لله عز وجل واستجابة لأمره.
نعم, okay, I mistranslated. So the first level is the lowest level, which is that person he does an action, hope for reward, and hope to be protected from punishment. The second is the middle level, where a person does a righteous action sincerely for Allah because he wants to be thankful and grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
أعلى المراتب أن يعمل الطاعة محبة لله وتعظيما لله وإجلالا لله ومهابة لله, وهذه مرتبة الصديقين.
And the highest level is where a person he does a righteous action out of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is the highest level, the level of those who are truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
والتوبة أيها الأخوة واجبة على الدوام.
And repentance, oh my brothers, is obligatory constantly.
والذنب الوقوع في الذنب من طبع الإنسان.
Falling into sin is something which is natural for a person.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم كل ابن آدم خطاء وخير الخطائين التوابون.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said that all of the sons of Adam fall into mistakes, but the best of those that commit these mistakes are those who repent and turn back to him.
وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم لو لم تذنبوا لذهب الله بكم وجاء بقوم يذنبون فيستغفرون الله فيغفر لهم.
And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in a hadith that if you were not to commit sins, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would get rid of you and bring a people that would sin just so that they can return back to Allah and seek His forgiveness and that Allah can forgive them.
وتأخير التوبة والإصرار على الذنب هذا خطأ يقع فيه الإنسان.
And as for a person who delays repentance, tawbah, and he continues doing that sin, then this is a grave mistake.
والشيطان يريد أن يظهر من الإنسان بعقبة من سبع عقبات, يعني سبع أشياء إذا ما قدر على واحد يحاول في الثانية في الثالثة في الرابعة في الخامسة في السادسة في السابعة. أخطر عقبة يريد الشيطان أن يوقع الإنسان فيها الشرك.
أسف الشيطان,
عقبة الشرك والكفر.
As for shaitan, then there are seven categories that shaitan wants us to fall into by not turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The most dangerous and worst of them is that shaitan, he wants us to fall into shirk and kufr.
لأن هذه المصيبة وهذه العقبة لا تبقي شيئا من أجر الأعمال. لئن أشركت لأحبطن عملك. إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء.
Because if a person falls into kufr and shirk, then it nullifies all of his actions. Then أشركت ليحبطن عملك. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that if you were to commit shirk, then he will make all of your actions become nullified. And likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive the one who commits shirk with him, ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. But Allah forgives anything lesser than shirk.
لم يستطع الشيطان أن يوقع الإنسان في الكفر, يوقعه في البدعة. يوقعه إيش في البدعة في الاعتقاد وترك الاقتداء بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه.
And then if Shaytan is not able to make you commit shirk or kufr, it comes to the second level, which is that he makes you fall into innovations. And innovations, whether it's in a person's belief or in a person's actions, and leaving off following the methodology of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and likewise the Sahaba.
فإن لم يستطع أوقعه في الكبائر.
And if he's not able to make you commit innovations, he makes you fall into major sins.
فإن لم يستطع أوقعه في الصغائر.
And if he's not able to make you fall into major sins, then minor sins.
فإن لم يستطع فبالإكثار من المباحات.
And if he's not able to make you do minor sins, then this is number five, he makes you increase in doing permissible actions.
فإن لم يستطع ففي الطاعات التي غيرها أفضل منها. يعني يجعله يشتغل بطاعة لكن يترك طاعة أفضل منها.
And if he's not able to make busy you with permissible actions and you're just doing righteous actions, he'll try to make you do those actions where the reward is less and leave off those which are greater.
فإن لم يستطع فبتسليط شياطين الإنس والجن. فإن لم يستطع فبتسليط شياطين الإنس والجن.
يعني
نعم
ما معنى ذلك؟
يعني إن لم يستطع هذه السبعة ينتقل إلى أن يسلط على الإنسان يعني من يعاديه من الإنس أو الجن. فهو عدو مبين يجب الاستعاذة منه. نعم.
نعم. And if he's not able to for you to do any of this, then he overpowers you and tries to make you distract others from and tries to make others fall into these seven or these six now these seven stages.
والمعاصي أقسام كبائر وهي ما ورد فيه حد في الدنيا أو وعيد في الآخرة أو غضب أو لعنة أو نفي إيمان.
Sins are of two types. We have kabair, major sins, and this is where it is any sin where connected to it is a punishment in this life or the hereafter or the punishment of Allah or the anger of Allah or the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
والقسم الثاني صغائر وهي ما دون ذلك.
And then the second type of sins are minor sins, which is anything which doesn't fall into the major sins.
وهناك أسباب تحول الصغائر إلى كبائر.
We also have some means that even though a person does a minor sin, it can cause that minor sin to become a major sin.
أهمها الإصرار على الصغائر.
The most important of these means is being consistent upon these minor sins.
أو تكرارها.
Or just doing them again and again.
أو احتقارها.
Or belittling them.
أو الافتخار بالظفر بها.
Or mocking them.
أو المجاهرة بفعلها.
Or openly mentioning that you commit this sin.
والتوبة تصح من جميع الذنوب.
And
كل الذنوب. نعم.
Repentance and tawbah and asking Allah for forgiveness is legislated and correct from any sin that a person commits.
وهي باقية حتى تطلع الشمس من مغربها أو تغرغر الروح في سكرات الموت.
And we are able to repent back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the sun rises from the west or until a person's soul is extracted from his body.
وجزاء التائب إن صدق في توبته أن الله يبدل سيئاته إلى حسنات وإن بلغت عنان السماء كثرة.
And the reward or the recompense of a person who turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will change all of the bad deeds that he did and make him into righteous actions even if his sins were to reach the clouds.
ولذلك قال تعالى فأولئك يعني التائبين فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات وكان الله غفورا رحيما.
That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he says فأولئك those people that turn back to Allah and ask him for forgiveness يبدل الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes the bad deeds into good deeds and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all forgiving and all merciful.
ولقبول التوبة شروط الأول الإقلاع عن الذنب.
And for the acceptance of repentance, there are a number of conditions. The first is that person completely leaves off that sin.
الثاني الندم على ما مضى منه.
Number two is that person is regretful.
الثالث العزم المؤكد على أن لا يعود للذنب في المستقبل.
The third is that a person has a firm determination never to do that sin ever again.
وإذا كان الذنب يتعلق بحقوق الخلق فلا بد من رد المظالم إلى أهلها.
And if the sin is connected to the rights of the people, for example, you've taken somebody's money or something like that, then it is obligatory to return the right of that person.
من أعمال القلوب العظيمة الصدق.
And from the great actions of the hearts is truthfulness.
وهو أصل أعمال القلوب كلها.
And this is the foundation of all of the actions of the hearts.
والصدق يستعمل في ست معاني. صدق في القول.
And truthfulness is implemented in six different things. The first is in speech.
صدق في الإرادة والقصد الإخلاص.
The second is truthfulness in a person's intention.
صدق في العزم.
Number three is truthfulness in determination.
صدق في الوفاء بالعزم.
The number four is truthfulness in completing that determination.
صدق في العمل.
Number five is being truthful in the action itself.
بأن يوافق ظاهره باطنه كالخشوع في الصلاة.
So being truthful in the action means that whatever a person shows outwardly is the same as what is in the heart.
صدق في تحقيق مقامات الدين كلها.
And the last is being truthful in implementing and affirming all of the aspects of the religion.
وهو أعلى الدرجات وأعز الدرجات.
And this is the greatest and highest of levels.
كالصدق في الخوف.
So to the person be truthful in his fear of Allah.
والرجاء.
And his hope in the reward of Allah.
والتعظيم.
And the glorification of Allah.
والزهد.
And asceticism.
والرضا.
And contentment.
والتوكل.
And reliance.
والحب.
And love.
وسائر أعمال القلوب.
And all of the other actions of the heart.
فمن اتصف في الصدق بالصدق في جميع ما ذكر فهو صديق.
So whoever is truthful in everything which has been mentioned now, then that person is known as a صديق.
لأنه مبالغ في الصدق.
Because he has a lot of truthfulness, i.e., in every single aspect of his life.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم عليكم بالصدق. فإن الصدق يهدي إلى البر وإن البر يهدي إلى الجنة وما زال الرجل يصدق ويتحرى الصدق حتى يكتب عند الله صديقا.
And this is why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said upon you is to be truthful. Obligatory upon you is to be truthful because صدق truthfulness takes a person to righteousness and righteousness takes a person to paradise and a person continues being truthful until he is written with Allah سبحانه وتعالى as a صديق.
ومن التبس عليه الحق فصدق الله في طلبه دون هوى في نفسه وفق إليه غالبا.
And whoever he is confused regarding what the truth is, if he is truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide him to the truth.
فإن لم يصبه عذره الله.
And if he is not able to reach the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him.
وضد الصدق الكذب.
And the opposite of truthfulness is lying.
وأول ما يسري الكذب من النفس إلى اللسان.
And the first thing that the lying of the heart reaches is lying upon the tongue.
فيفسده.
And it corrupts the tongue.
ثم يسري إلى الجوارح فيفسد أعمالها.
And then it moves on to a person's limbs and then it nullifies the actions that he does.
كما أفسد على اللسان أقواله.
Just as it nullifies the statements that come out of the
فيعم الكذب أقواله وأعماله وأحواله.
So therefore, when you talk about kathib, lying, it includes whatever is in the heart and upon the tongue and his limbs and everything that he does.
فيستحكم عليها الفساد.
And then that kathib, it causes a person to be shrouded in corruption.
من أعمال القلوب المحبة.
From the actions of the heart is loving.
بمحبة الله.
Loving Allah.
ورسوله.
And his messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم.
والمؤمنين.
And the believers.
تنال حلاوة الإيمان محبة الله ومحبة رسوله ومحبة المؤمنين تنال حلاوة الإيمان.
And when a person loves Allah and His Messenger and the believers, that's when he tastes the sweetness of iman.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم ثلاث من كن فيه وجد بهن حلاوة الإيمان أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما وأن يحب المرأة لا يحبه إلا لدينه وأن يكره أن يرجع إلى الكفر كما يكره أن يقذف في النار.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said three things that if a person has, then he will taste the sweetness of iman. The first is to love Allah and the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم more than everything else. And the second is to love a person for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And the third is to hate to go back to kufr just as a person would hate to be thrown into the fire.
فإذا غرست شجرة المحبة في القلب وسقيت بماء الإخلاص ومتابعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أثمرت أنواع الثمار.
If a person he plants the love of Allah سبحانه وتعالى in his heart and then he waters that what he has planted with sincerity and following the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, then he will see the sweetness of iman and the beautiful effects of it.
وآتت أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها.
And he will be able to eat and enjoy all of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وهي أربعة أنواع محبة الله.
And loving is of four types.
Number one is أصل الإيمان.
The first is loving Allah and this is the foundation of iman.
المحبة في الله والبغض في الله وهي واجبة.
The second is loving for the sake of Allah and hating for the sake of Allah and this is from iman.
محبة مع الله وهي إشراك غير الله في المحبة الواجبة كمحبة المشركين لأوثانهم وأصنامهم وهي أصل الشرك.
The third is loving other than Allah in a similar manner to loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is shirk, just like the mushrikun used to love the idols.
محبة طبيعية كمحبة الوالدين والأولاد والطعام وهي جائزة.
And then you have a natural type of love where a person loves his parents and his children, and that is permissible.
من أهم أعمال القلوب التوكل.
From the important actions of the heart is reliance.
وهو تفويض القلب واعتماده على الله عز وجل في حصول المطلوب.
Which is depending and relying upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in attaining that which you want.
ودفع المكروه.
Or in removing harm.
مع الثقة بالله.
Whilst trusting Allah.
وفعل الأسباب المشروعة.
And also completing the means which have been legislated.
فترك تفويض القلب طعن في التوحيد.
If a person leaves off reliance upon Allah, then that is an issue in a person's tawheed.
وترك الأسباب المشروعة عجز ونقص في العقل.
And if a person leaves off taking the means that lead to what he wants, then that is a deficiency in a person's intellect.
ومحله قبل الفعل.
And where does a person have tawakkul? It is before doing the action.
وهو ثمرة اليقين.
And having reliance upon Allah is the fruit or the benefit of having certainty.
وأنواعه ثلاثة واجب.
And there are three types. The first is wajib.
وهو التوكل على الله فيما لا يقدر عليه إلا الله.
Which is to have reliance upon Allah in that which only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can do.
كشفاء المرضى.
In that which only Allah can do, such as curing the ill.
محرم وهو على نوعين.
And then we have a impermissible type of
شرك أكبر.
And it's the impermissible type of tawakkul is two types. The first is shirk akbar, major shirk.
وهو الاعتماد الكلي على الأسباب.
This is where a person fully depends only on the means.
وأنها تؤثر استقلالا في جلب المنفعة أو دفع المضرة.
And that person believes that the means that by itself independently from Allah is what causes harm or benefit.
وشرك أصغر.
And the second is minor shirk.
كالاعتماد على شخص في الرزق.
So to the person depending on somebody else for wealth.
من غير استقلاليته في التأثير.
But he doesn't believe that it is separate from Allah.
لكن التعلق به فوق اعتقاد أنه مجرد سبب.
But he is connected to that means more than just a belief that it is a means.
جائز وهو أن يوكل الإنسان غيره ويعتمد عليه في فعل ما يقدر عليه.
And the third type of tawakkul is a permissible type, which is that a person depends on somebody else, but he believes that it's only a means, and his true reliance is upon Allah.
كالبيع والشراء.
Such as buying and selling.
لكن لا يجوز أن يقول توكلت على الله ثم عليك، بل يقول وكلتك.
But it's not permissible for a person in Arabic to say توكلت, that I have توكل upon Allah and upon you, but rather he used to use another word, which is وكلت, which has a different meaning.
ومن أعمال القلوب الشكر.
From the actions of the heart is gratitude.
ظهور أثر النعمة الإلهية على العبد في قوله إيمانا وفي لسانه حمدا وفي جوارحه عبادة.
And how do we show gratitude to Allah? It is by our hearts, by having iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is with our tongues by thanking and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is with our limbs by worshipping Allah
subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So gratitude to Allah has to have all three, our hearts, our tongues, and our limbs.
ومعنى الشكر أن تستعمل النعمة في طاعة الله عز وجل.
And the meaning, so therefore the meaning of shukr, gratitude to Allah, is that you use that blessing in a manner which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
من أعمال القلوب الصبر.
From the actions of the heart also is patience.
وهو ترك الشكوى لغير الله من ألم البلوى.
And that is to leave off complaining. Leave of complaining for anyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وصرفها إلى الله تعالى.
And that a person turns only to Allah.
قال تعالى إنما يوفى الصابرون أجرهم بغير حساب.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that verily Allah rewards those that have patience without any limit.
وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم من يتصبر يصبره الله.
And the Prophet said that whoever has patience, then Allah will give him true patience.
وما أعطي أحد عطاء خيرا من وأوسع من الصبر.
And nobody has been given anything better than الصبر.
يقول عمر رضي الله عنه ما ابتليت ببلاء إلا كان لله تعالى علي فيه أربع نعم.
Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that I have not been afflicted with any affliction except during the affliction Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me with four blessings.
إذ لم يكن في ديني,
if the calamity was not in my religion,
وإذ لم يكن أعظم,
and it's not something that could have been worse,
وإذ لم أحرم الرضا به,
and I'm still content and pleased with Allah,
وإذ أرجو الثواب عليه,
and I, during that trial and tribulation, I hope for the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
والصبر درجات دنيا وهي ترك الشكوى مع الكراهة.
And patience itself has different levels. The lowest level is that person leaves off complaining to other than Allah, but he still dislikes the fact that this has happened.
ووسطى وهي ترك الشكوى مع الرضا.
And then there's a middle level where a person leaves off complaining, but he is content with the decree of Allah.
وعليا وهي حمد الله على البلاء.
And the highest level is where a person is thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that affliction.
ومن ظلم فدعا على ظالمه فقد انتصر لنفسه وأخذ حقه ولم يصبر.
And if a person is oppressed, then he makes dua to Allah against the oppressor, then the reward of patience there has been taken and he's placed it in that dua instead.
وجميع ما يلقى العبد في الدنيا لا يخلو من نوعين.
And everything which happens to a person in this life is of two types.
ما يوافق الهوى فيحتاج إلى صبر في أداء حق الله فيه من الشكر.
The first is that it is corresponding to a person's desires. So this requires a person to stay away from falling into those sins.
وعدم صرف شيء منها في معصية الله.
And to make sure that none of the blessings of Allah he uses in a way which is displeasing to Allah.
والمخالف للهوى وهو على ثلاث أقسام.
And then there are those things that happen to a person which go against what he desires.
صبر على طاعة الله,
which is having patience upon the obedience of Allah.
والواجب منه فعل الفرض والمستحب فعل النفل.
And what's obligatory in regards to the obedience of Allah is to do that which is obligatory, and a higher level is to do that which is recommended.
صبر عن معصية الله.
The second is to have patience from falling into the disobedience.
والواجب منه ترك المحرم.
And what's obligatory is to leave off that which is haram.
والمستحب منه ترك المكروه.
And it's recommended to leave off that which is makruh.
الثالث الصبر على أقدار الله عز وجل.
The third is to have patience from the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
والواجب منه حبس اللسان عن التشكي.
And what's obligatory is that a person controls his tongue from saying anything which would displease Allah.
وحبس القلب عن الاعتراض والتسخط على قدر الله.
And he also stops his heart from turning against Allah, being ungrateful to Allah.
وحبس الجوارح عن التصرف في غير ما يرضي الله.
And he also stops his limbs from doing anything which displeases Allah.
من النياحة,
such as wailing.
شق الجيوب,
or hitting themselves.
لطم الخدود,
such as hitting themselves and ripping their clothes.
وغير ذلك.
And other things as well.
والمستحب منه الرضا القلبي بما قدر الله.
And what is recommended is that a person is content in his heart with whatever Allah has decreed.
كم بقي معنا وقت؟
ما أدري.
موضوع كثير. من أعمال القلوب الخشوع.
خمس دقائق وعشرة.
من أعمال القلوب الخشوع.
From the actions of the hearts is having humility and concentration.
وهو التعظيم والانكسار والذل.
And that is to glorify Allah whilst also humiliating yourself or realizing how low you are.
قال حذيفة رضي الله عنه إياكم وخشوع النفاق.
حذيفة رضي الله عنه, he said, beware of the خشوع of hypocrisy.
قيل له ما خشوع النفاق؟
So he was asked, what is that?
أن ترى الجسد خاشعا والقلب ليس بخاشع. قال أن ترى الجسد خاشعا والقلب ليس خاشعا.
And Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he replied, this is where a person, he shows that his limbs have khushu' and humility in front of Allah, but his heart is not the same and his heart is heedless.
وأول ما تفقدون من دينكم الخشوع.
And he said, the first thing which will be lost from your religion is khushu'.
وأي عبادة يشرع فيها الخشوع فإن الأجر فيها بقدر الخشوع كالصلاة.
And any action which contains khushu', then the reward of that action is dependent upon the level of khushu' that a person has, such as salah.
فلذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس المصلي من صلاته إلا ما عقل. جاء في الحديث نصفها ربعها خمسها عشرها.
And the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith that the person who prays will only attain the reward of that where he used his intellect, i.e. how much khushu' and concentration he had. And in other narrations, it mentions how the Prophet mentioned that a person will pray and he will only leave the salah with the 10th of the reward, or the 9th of the reward, or the 8th of the reward, or 7th, till the end of the hadith.
بل قد يكون ليس له من صلاته شيء لعدم وجود الخشوع فيها تماما.
And it may even be that a person prays salah but he has no reward whatsoever because he had no khushu'.
من أعمال القلوب الرجاء.
From the actions of the heart is hope.
وهو النظر إلى سعة رحمة الله عز وجل.
Which is looking at the vastness of the mercy of Allah.
وضده اليأس.
And the opposite is despairing from Allah, the mercy of Allah.
والعمل على الرجاء أعلى منه على الخوف.
And acting upon the hope in the mercy of Allah is greater than doing an action out of fear of Allah.
لأنه يورث حسن الظن بالله.
Because having hope, it also causes other effects such as having good thoughts of Allah.
والله يقول في الحديث القدسي أنا عند حسن ظن عبدي بي.
And in the Hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that my station is according to the good thoughts that the slave has regarding me.
وهو درجتان عليا.
And this is of two types, the high level.
من عمل طاعة ويرجو ثواب الله.
Which is where a person does an action and he hopes for the reward of Allah.
قالت عائشة يا رسول الله قل الله تعالى والذين يؤتون ما آتوا وقلوبهم وجلة هو الذي يسرق ويزني ويشرب الخمر وهو يخاف الله قال لا يا بنت الصديق ولكنهم الذين يصلون ويصومون ويتصدقون وهم يخافون ألا يقبل منهم.
And so Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding the hadith, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا أَتَوْا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ, that those people that have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their hearts. She asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are those the people that commit zina, those people that steal and so on? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, O daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Rather, this ayah regarding people who have the fear of Allah is regarding those people who have done righteous actions but they fear that the action will not be accepted from them.
كما قال تعالى أولئك يسارعون في الخيرات.
Such as the statement of Allah where He says, they are those people who hasten in doing righteous actions.
هذه المرتبة العليا، المرتبة الدنيا المذنب التائب يرجو مغفرة الله.
And the lower level of رجاء is a person who has sinned but he hopes that Allah will forgive his sin.
أما العاصي المصر التارك للتوبة ويرجو رحمة الله فهذا تمني وليس رجاء.
As for a person who continues doing that sin and he says that I hope that Allah will forgive me, then this is a false hope and it's not true hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is dispraiseworthy. And the first level that we mentioned is the praiseworthy. So a believer is somebody who combines between excellency in the action and then fear that it may not be accepted from him.
والمنافق جمع إساءة وأمنا.
And as for the munafiq, he is the one that does bad in the action, but then he feels free and safe from the punishment of Allah.
من أعمال القلوب ولعل نختم به وهو الخوف.
And the last action of the heart that we mentioned today is having the fear of Allah.
وهو غم يلحق النفس لتوقع مكروه.
And khawf, fear is where a person has that feeling in his heart due to something taking place that he dislikes.
فإن تيقن المكروه سمي خشية.
And if a person has certainty of that of what he dislikes taking place, that is known as خشية.
وضده الأمن.
And the opposite of it is feeling safe.
وهو ليس بضد للرجاء بل هو باعث بطريق الرهبة.
And khawf, fear of Allah is not the opposite of having it's not the opposite of hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it is fear of the punishment that will take place from the sins.
والرجاء باعث بطريق الرغبة.
And as for رجاء, as for hope, then a person attains hope by reading about the rewards of Allah.
ولا بد من الجمع بين المحبة والخوف والرجاء هذه الثلاثة.
And a person has to combine between these three, having love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having hope in his reward and his mercy, and fearing his punishment.
قال الإمام ابن القيم القلب في سيره إلى الله بمنزلة الطائر.
Ibn al-Qayyim رحمه الله, he says that the heart in its journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like a bird.
فالمحبة رأسه.
The love is the head of that bird.
والخوف والرجاء جناحه.
And hope and fear are the two wings of that bird.
فإذا سكن الخوف القلب أحرق مواضع الشهوات منها.
And if fear is embedded into a person's heart, then it will stop a person from falling into sin.
وطرد الدنيا عنها.
And it will turn away from this dunya.
والخوف الواجب هو ما حمل على فعل الواجبات وترك المحرمات.
And the different types of fear, that which is obligatory type of fear, is that fear which causes a person to not fall into haram and to do that which is obligatory.
والخوف المستحب هو ما حمل على فعل المستحبات وترك المكروهات.
And that type of fear which is recommended is that fear which causes a person to do that which is recommended and stay away from that which is disliked.
والخوف من غير الله أنواع.
Fearing other than Allah is of different types.
شرك أكبر.
The first is major shirk.
وهو خوف السر.
Which is a hidden type of fear.
والتأله.
And of divinity.
ويجب أن يكون لله وحده.
And this is, it's obligatory that this type of fear is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
كالخوف من آلهة المشركين أن تضر أو تصيب بمكروه.
Such as having fear that certain idols will harm you and so on.
شرك أصغر وهو ترك واجب أو فعل محرم خوفا من الناس.
The minor type of shirk here, of fear, is that a person leaves off an action out of fear that he will receive some harm from the people.
جائز وهو كالخوف الطبيعي من الذنب وغيره.
And then there's a permissible type of fear where a person fears a predator or an enemy and so on.
إذن أيها الأخوة قطب راح العبودية هو المحبة والخوف والرجاء.
Therefore, my brothers, the essence of worship is based upon these three: love, hope, and fear.
فهي أركان العبودية.
And these are considered the pillars of worship.
قال الله تعالى: أولئك الذين يدعون يبتغون إلى ربهم الوسيلة أيهم أقرب.
Allah سبحانه وتعالى, He says in the Quran, أولئك الذين يبتغون, they are people that hope and they want to get closer to Allah سبحانه وتعالى.
ويرجون رحمته.
And they hope for the mercy of Allah.
ويخافون عذابه.
And they fear the punishment of Allah.
إن عذاب ربك كان محذورا.
And verily the عذاب, the punishment of Allah سبحانه وتعالى.
قال الشيخ السعدي في تفسيره.
إمام السعدي said in تفسير this آية.
أولئك الذين يدعون, يعني من الأنبياء والصالحين والملائكة.
That those people who make dua to Allah is referring to the prophets, angels, and righteous people.
يبتغون إلى ربهم الوسيلة أيهم أقرب أن يتنافسون في القرب من ربهم.
And then they compete with one another to get closer to their Lord.
ويبذلون ما يقدرون عليه من الأعمال الصالحة المقربة إلى الله عز وجل.
And they do whatever they can from righteous actions to get close to Allah.
وإلى رحمته.
And to His mercy.
ويخافون عذابه.
And at the same time, they fear his punishment.
فيجتنبون كل ما يوصل إلى العذاب.
So they stay away from anything which causes a person to attain punishment.
إن عذاب ربك كان محذورا.
And verily, the ما معنى محذورا في آية؟
أي هو الذي ينبغي شدة الحذر منه.
And then Allah سبحانه وتعالى ends the ayah by saying that the punishment of Allah سبحانه وتعالى is something which a person should fear and stay away the most.
والتوقي من أسبابه.
And also stay away from anything which takes a person close to that punishment.
وهذه الأمور الثلاثة الخوف والرجاء والمحبة التي وصف الله بها هؤلاء المقربين عنده هي الأصل والمادة في كل خير.
And these three things, love, hope, and fear, they are the foundation of every goodness.
فمن تمت له أموره.
So whoever completes these three things will complete all of his actions.
وإذا خلى القلب منها ترحلت عنه الخيرات.
And if the heart is free and does not have these three things, then all of goodness will be.
وأحاطت به الشرور.
And all evil will surround him.
وعلامة المحبة.
And a sign of a person's love.
ما ذكره الله أن يجتهد العبد في كل عمل يقربه إلى الله.
Is that a person he exerts effort in doing any action which causes the love of Allah.
وينافس في قربه بإخلاص الأعمال كلها لله.
And he competes with others by doing any action that takes him closer to Allah.
والنصح فيها.
And also by upholding the rights of Allah.
وإيقاعها على أكمل الوجوه المقدور عليها.
And completing them in the best possible form that he can.
فمن زعم أنه يحب الله بغير ذلك فهو كاذب.
So whoever claims that he loves Allah without doing these things, then he is a liar.
قال شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى.
شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله said.
قال بعض السلف.
That some of the Salaf said.
من عبد الله بالحب وحده فهو صديق.
That whoever worships Allah with love alone, then he is a heretic.
يعني محبة بدون عمل بدون اعتقاد هذا زنديق.
Meaning the person who says I love Allah but there's no action behind it, he's a heretic and a hypocrite.
ومن عبده بالخوف وحده فهو حروري يعني خارجي.
And whoever worships Allah سبحانه وتعالى with fear alone,
يعني خوف بدون محبة وبدون رجاء.
Yeah, he only has a fear of Allah, there's no love of Allah, and there's no hope in the mercy of Allah, then that person is from the Khawarij.
ومن عبده بالرجاء وحده فهو مرجئ.
And whoever worships Allah سبحانه وتعالى with hope only, then he is a murji'i from the people of innovation.
ومن عبده بالحب والخوف والرجاء فهو موحد.
And whoever worships Allah with love, fear and hope, then he is a person who has affirmed the tawhid of Allah.
فأركان العبادة محبة وخوف ورجاء.
So therefore the pillars of worship is love, fear and hope.
قال ابن القيم رحمه الله هذه الثلاثة هي قطب رحل عبودية وعليها دارت رحل أعمال.
And Ibn Qayyim رحمه الله he said that these three things are the foundation and the essence of servitude and worship to Allah سبحانه وتعالى.
نكتفي بهذا القدر وإن كان الموضوع طويل لكن كما قيل يكفي من القلادة ما أحاط بالعنق صلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
And the Sheikh said, we will suffice with this, even though this topic is long and large and vast, we will suffice with this, bi-izhinillah, due to time. JazakAllah khair. So alhamdulillah, that was the first lecture by Sheikh Abdulislam Al-Suhaimi. We now move on to the second lecture, which will be delivered by Sheikh Abdul Latif Shamani, who is a teacher in the Faculty of Sharia, and also in the Islamic University of Medina, and also a teacher in Al-Masjid Nabawi, the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.